Welcome back to the Esserform channel and thanks for tuning in. In this particular episode, I wanted to share with you my attempt to capture and post-process the Crescent Nebula. And as you probably know, the Crescent Nebula is a famous deep sky object located in the constellation Cygnus. So, without further ado, let's get into it. So this is just a quick update for those of you who are following me more regularly. So as you probably know, I recently acquired the Skywatcher EQ6R Pro, which you can see here. I had an issue with the right ascension motor with the belt drive that kept falling off. I consulted with Rob from Robotics and he wants to fix it for me. He says the problem is very easy to fix, so that's good to hear. But in the meanwhile, if you saw my last video, I put a piece of plastic in the right ascension motor to keep like the belt drive in place. And it's working perfectly. I have been guiding for a couple of nights now at sub-arc accuracy, so 0.6 to 0.8 on the right ascension motor. And actually this is with my mount that is currently not really well balanced, so I'm pretty happy with it and I'm actually considering just keeping it as it is. But anyway, let's move on to the Crescent Nebula. So hi people, of course I want to focus on the data that I was able to capture on the Crescent Nebula across multiple nights, but also I just want to take a minute to show you the Starlink satellite streaks that end up more often in my pictures lately. And I know that you don't want me to complain too much about it, so I will also provide you with a positive spin on this story. I will provide you with some positive news on this, so please bear with me. So yeah, it is true that I see more and more satellites, or I think they are Starlink satellites, in my picture. So you can see here, often I take like 5 minute exposures of a deep sky object. And you can see here the Crescent Nebula, the shell is a little bit showing in a sulfur image. So using the sulfur filter, narrowband filter. And you can see here that, yeah, clearly we have two satellite streaks. I think there are Starlink satellites that are trying to reach their designated orbit in my field of view. And yeah, I have many of those pictures. So here's another example. And here's another example. And yeah, for the Crescent Nebula, I think I ended up with about 8 or 9 pictures which had satellite streaks on my picture. So about 40 to 45 minutes of data actually. I had to laugh about this one. I'm currently in the process of capturing the Pelican Nebula. And you can see here two Starlink satellites also, I think they're Starlinks, crossing my field of view. And actually it looks a little bit like they are decapitating the head of the Pelican in the Pelican Nebula. So I had to laugh a little bit about this one. Yeah, but of course in general I really hate seeing these satellite streaks in my pictures. But now on to the good news, because yeah, at least in PixInsight I'm often using the, and please bear with me, I'm still new and I'm still learning how to use PixInsight. I'm using the image integration module or process, I would have to say. And I think a lot of people in PixInsight use the image integration process to stack all of their images into one overall image, basically. And yeah, this is not a tutorial, but just showing you what I did. So, as a pixel rejection algorithm, I often choose the Sigma clipping rejection algorithm because I have like over 30 pictures on a single deep sky object. If you have less than 30 or 20 pictures on a single deep sky object, you can also use the Winsorized Sigma clipping, by the way. And actually I left these settings pretty much to default, and I just wanted to show you what happens when you do. So I left these Starlink streaks or satellite streaks in my pictures. I left these frames in my picture. And then when you look at the rejection frame that the image integration process produces, then you can see that a lot of these satellite streaks, they are actually being recognized as non-common data. So this is actually has been recognized as some kind of outlier that will not be included in your final stacked image. So that's actually pretty good news. And for let me show you also the final stack, for instance, of the sulfur here. You can see that none of these Starlink streaks appear in my final stacked image. And so I'm actually pretty positive about this. So maybe we will actually survive all of these low Earth orbit satellites in terms of astrophotography, in terms of algorithms being able to reject those streaks as non-common data. Okay, people, enough complaining. Let's move on to the good stuff. Let's move on to the stacked pictures of the Crescent Nebula. So let's start out with the most beautiful one. The hydrogen alpha stack. So I was really excited to see this. So you are looking here at an integrated picture of about 65 frames using my hydrogen alpha filter. So I have been using my narrowband filters to capture the Crescent Nebula. And these are actually the 7 nanometer ZWO narrowband filters that I'm using. And yeah, this is just the 65 frames of 5 minute exposure time each stacked together. And I was kind of worried at first that I might not be able to capture the details in the Crescent Nebula because I was using my wide field or pretty wide field APO 80 millimeter refractor. But when we zoom in on the Crescent Nebula, I was very excited to see that, Christmas tree structure, let me call it like this, it really shows in the stacked hydrogen alpha image. So great. I was really excited. And also some of the nebulosity I showed you, like from the star, the Sutter, is also here showing in the picture. I really like this this one. So let's move on to a stack that I was a little bit less enthusiastic about. The sulfur stack. So you can see it here. So although I was pretty good focused on the stars, so when you look at the stars, I think I was pretty well focused there around. But still, the Crescent Nebula in sulfur, at least, it doesn't show a lot of detail. So you can see this like this blob representing the Crescent Nebula, but there's not a lot of details in this picture. And also when we look at the nebulosity, and especially when you compare this to the hydrogen alpha. So this is the hydrogen alpha picture, and this is the sulfur. So let's do an overlay here. So the sulfur here, and then the hydrogen alpha is this one. So yeah, the sulfur, it just shows less detail. And actually, I have been ignoring this sulfur in my further post-processing attempts. I will show you that in the next clip. But let's move on to the oxygen 3. So the oxygen filter, so the blue part basically of the image, it showed some details on the Crescent Nebula. So I was pretty happy with that also, because I was looking I really wanted to capture this bluish kind of shell some pictures have around the Crescent Nebula. And at least the data here is in on that blue shell. So you can clearly see that there's some structure showing here of the Crescent Nebula, and you can see here the surroundings. But actually, when you look very closely at the stars, you can see that I was not completely focused, guys and girls. I was not completely focused. So I didn't pay enough attention in Sequence Generator Pro during my capturing session. So, but anyway, I of course have worked with this stacked image. This is actually the data I have been able to collect. Just let me quickly show you how I tried to post-process all of the mono images to get one overall colored picture of the Crescent Nebula using all of my narrowband images. And actually, I spent a lot of time on this one. So I just wanted to show you some things using
pixel math. So I ended up using pixel math to combine all of these images, and let me reset pixel math here. I have been using pixel math to combine all of the mono images into one overall colored picture. And yeah, let me just show you what I experimented with. So I checked off here this use a single expression, and I clicked here on the expression editor. And then this is really, really helpful. You can just go on and combine here different stacked mono images that you have collected for the red, the green, and the blue part. And I think the A, it represents the luminosity, right? So a luminosity layer on top of the RGB, I think. So let's do like a first thing you always want to do is I was looking for a red crescent nebula because it's the hydrogen alpha stack. The hydrogen alpha stack shows the crescent nebula in great detail, and actually the hydrogen alpha filter is actually within the red part of the light spectrum. So I wanted to have the crescent nebula to have this natural color. So H alpha in the red, and then S2 would then be often used for the green part of the picture, and then the blue the oxygen filter would represent the blue part of the picture. And then I also wanted to use the hydrogen alpha stack picture as an overall like luminance layer. So I first started with this, and I wanted to create a new image, and then I have to select this as an RGB color image. So when I try, I have to have one window open for some reason. So when I try to run this, so let's run it. So the first integrated image I came up with is actually this picture. Dun, 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 dun. This. And yeah, what can I say? I mean, it's not bad. But there were several things I did not like about this picture. So first of all, the crescent nebula had a little bit of a purple glow instead of a reddish glow. And you can also see that the blue shell surrounding the crescent nebula, it is more geared towards the greenish kind of glow as compared to the really blue kind of glow that I was looking for the shell. And then we also end up with a lot of greenish looking stars here in the picture. So they are, this is because of the fact that we have included the sulfur stacked image here in the picture. And I was actually, the nebula was pretty decent. I was actually looking for this, like this gold-like structure in the nebula. So this is showing a little bit. I was not thrilled with this picture. I thought I need something different to further post-process. So let me just show you what you can do in PixInsight for those of you who are unfamiliar with this process, I should say. So when we go back to the expression editor, you can do so many combinations here. So first of all, I wasn't really happy with the green glow in my picture of all of these greenish stars. So what you can actually do is just to leave the S2 stacked image out and go for a so-called HOO picture. So an HOO picture basically means that the hydrogen stacked picture will be used for the red part of the picture. While using the O3, so the oxygen part, the oxygen stacked file for the green and the blue. So that's an HOO picture. So that's also a thing I tried. So let's just show you. Let's just run it and see what kind of result we get when we do that. So, okay, we have to leave one open for some reason. Right, stretch the image. And then we end up with this. So yeah, I was thinking I like this because I don't see any green in the picture. But still, I was thinking, yeah, this is a little bit orange looking crescent nebula. It should be geared a little bit more towards the red. And also the green-like structure, or the like the gold-like structure I really like. It's now geared a little bit more towards the red. But actually, I really see this as an improvement over the stack where I used the S2. So this is the S2 stack. And this is the HOO stack. So this is the HSO stack. So H for red for hydrogen alpha, green for sulfur, and blue was the oxygen filter. And this is the HOO stack. So I really like the HOO stack more, but still the nebula is not so well defined in the HOO stack. So I experimented a little bit further. So let me do some final thing here. HOO. What I did then was I was experimenting with this. So maybe the green part, you can tune it down a little bit. For instance, if you want you want the O3 to represent the green part, but you only want maybe 80% of that picture to show in the green part of your image. So you can just say the O3 stacked image should be included for about 80% in the overall RGB as instead of 100% in the green part of this image. I hope I'm making sense. And then for the blue part, I was thinking maybe I should combine a little bit of H alpha in the blue part of the picture. So I ended up with this setting. So like 85% for the blue part would be composed of the O3 stack I have. But you can then also include the H alpha stack, which is so rich in details. And you can then just say, okay, about 15% or 0.15. 15% of the blue part will consist of the hydrogen alpha data. So you can play around a lot with these. I think I left this at 75 actually in the end. And yeah, let's just try this one again. Again, I have to open one of the images to be able to run it. Don't ask me why. So let me show you this final integrated image. Waiting for my computer. So I think I used this one for further post-processing, and actually I ended up combining several stacks. But anyway, you can see here that the Crescent Nebula is nicely, it's like it has this reddish color, a little bit light, but okay, it has this reddish color. Also, it has the blue shell, not showing any green in it, so I really like that. And then, also you have this pronounced structure of the nebula surrounding the crescent. I just wanted to show you this so you can experiment a lot in pixel math to come up with an ideal combination of the narrow band stacks you end up with. So that's really nice. Before showing you the final picture, I just wanted to quickly ask you if you have any pictures that you want to share for my next update on the night sky in June. So I will make a video on the what is out there in the night sky in June, in about 2 weeks. If you want me to include some of your pictures that you have taken in May, you can share that picture on Instagram with me using the hashtag NSinfo. So night sky Astro Forum, so NSSpo actually. I'm so bad at this. Hashtag NSSpo, or include my handle, so @AstroForum on Instagram, and sharing your picture. And I will make a selection and show some of these pictures in my next June What's in the Night Sky update. Okay, I hope this information was a little bit useful. And if it was useful, consider giving this video a thumbs up. And please consider subscribing to my channel. Thank you very much. I hope to see you again in one of my other videos. And until then, I want to wish you